Welcome back. We are glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, feel free to get in touch with us. Tell us what you think about the program. And also, we're coming to the end of the year. What are some of the things you're doing to support your business? I know some people that are already strategizing on how they're going to make money through Christmas. But look, there are rumors of possible lockdown. But, you know, those are rumors. But as a business person, jump on every available opportunity and make some money, okay? Let's talk how to make money. And last week we aired the first segment of Nantongo Barbara Jen, the CEO of Smart Kitchen Solutions, a social enterprise in Mpeji offering clean cooking solutions. This week, in part two, we know that she's earning money according to part one, and she's employing a good number of women in the area. But whereas most business people wouldn't want to hear what their clients think, Nantongo says feedback has enabled her become more innovative on the product, make it more competitive and attractive to the clients. How to make money. For most people, starting a business is an opportunity to make money. And I'm sure you are working towards saving the environment, but making money could be one of the things you're looking at as well. There's a high rate of unemployment amongst the youth. And for a young lady like you,
yes,
how comfortable are you in running such a business overlooking for white collar jobs, and what impact would you say you're creating in society?
Okay, eventually, we are looking at the sustainability part of the business, because you cannot really look at donations or grants. How long will that happen? So you have to be sustainable, generate income. But however, at the end, we are saving the environment or creating impact. First of all, it's through employment. Me, I'll say it was to maybe start from me as a person. Employment opportunities in Uganda, it's so, the demand is so high that it's so competitive. It being so competitive, you have to be having connections. So me, coming from a humble family that I don't have much connections, then I have to find ways how to sustain myself, how to grow myself and achieve my dreams as me, a young girl. So it being a factor that at a certain point, I believe also other youth are facing the same challenge, because people are graduating out, people are dropping out of school, but what are they doing? They're just sitting home. Some are forced to do other things, being in prostitution, you know, stealing. Not that they want, but they want to get something for a living. So as Smart Kitchen Solutions, also we are looking at how best can we engage in the youth and young women in the whole value chain. So this is how we engage or create employment opportunities. It starts from the collection of raw materials. So far right now, we have 12 women that we are working with in the community. So they collect waste, we buy from them for them to get motivated. So at the end also, they are mobilizing their fellow women to have a proper disposal of waste. Because at the end, this waste also, it produces carbon emissions, which is affecting us as humans, though we are ignorant about it. So secondly, we have those that are engaged in the production, are engaged in the packaging, and also the women that also are selling, like they are getting a discount while selling our product. So that is the first, creating employment opportunities. Secondly, saving the environment. We are looking at reducing the cutting down of trees. As according to the research, one ton of briquettes serves three small trees of tree, three small trees. So you can imagine the more the adoption of the product, the more we reduce on the cutting down of trees. Currently, we are being hit so much by the climate change. Even right now, our people are realizing it, that the seasons are changing slowly by slowly. Fine, right now it's a rainy season, but it's too hot. But what is it causing it? Because of cutting down of trees. And the most reason for cutting down of trees, it's getting fuel, because we don't have any alternative to run to. But we are forced to get charcoal, firewood. At the end, we are cutting down trees, you know? So now also we are looking at improving the lives of people. While burning the charcoal and firewood, it produces smoke. So, and this in the long run, it doesn't happen in the short run, it happens in the long run, that people, they are being affected by respiratory diseases like lung cancer, asthma. So it's the smoke that produces, that exposes them to that. So us using them, using our product that is smoke free, then it helps them to improve their health as well, a cook in a clean environment.
Talk to us about market access. From the time you got ready with the first production, and you had the products ready, how has access to the market been, and what has been the reception from the clients?
The journey has been a tough one. It has not been just get a customer there and then. It has been a hassle, really changing their mindset, because most of them, they see something new and they don't believe it can really cook their food or cook a meal for them.
Talk to us about how important feedback from customers is and how it is helping you improve on your product.
The customers' feedback is very, very vital, very important, because there is no way you're going to stand as a business when you don't listen from the end users. There is no way you're going to grow. So the customer feedback from day one, it has made us who we are right now. Because without them, maybe even we couldn't have made the product that we are having right now. And us listening to them, whether bitter feedback, whether wood, it has really helped us to grow and also to improve ourselves personally, like to improve on our communication, to grow, like, because people have different perspective, you know. And also there is a scenario that someone really abused me in front of people, like it was a center, like your things don't work. That was a time of us prototyping, what it was bitter and so shameful, but we had to really take it in a good way to see, like, okay, we have to really work hard and really improve on our product. Yeah, so the customer feedback, it really pushes you and helps you to grow as a business and also to meet their need or their demand. Because if you don't meet their need, that means you're not solving a problem they are facing.
If you speak to five young people,
yes, please,
the biggest thing they will tell you that is limiting them from starting a business is access to finance. Do you think access to finance is the biggest challenge most young people face, or there's more that needs to be done in terms of management, skills, market access and all that?
I think it is, there is extra more than the access to funds. Because imagine someone coming to give you maybe 10 million and you don't have any idea, you don't have any skill, what are you going to use it for? So it's capital, I could say capital is not a problem. But the problem is getting the knowledge and starting, because there is no way someone is going to come and give you a push when you have not started. So it's all about what you have in your head, starting it, putting it into, just implement it. When you implement it, trust me, you're going to attract more people and also engaging your people around in your circle, talking more about what you do. It will really help you to attract funds. But the first thing is, how have you started? Do you have the skills? Do you have the knowledge? Do you have the foundation of you as a person who is starting? Because as a business person, you have to really be well equipped on how best you are going to manage the funds in the future that you may have got.
So there you have it. If you believe you can do it, it's always important that you try out something new. And as a business person, listening from your clients is always important, because when they tell you what they think about a product, then you'll be able to think, okay, should I innovate this? Should I add this? Should I reduce that? Remember, if your customers are happy, then by all means, your business should be thriving. Because if you run a business that aims at ensuring the well-being of the society, then I mean, why not? Things should be working for you.
So, hello, Charles.
Hi, Cynthia.
Tell us about yourself. Who are you?
Charles Katongole, Head of Financial Markets with Standard Chartered Bank. I support a team that supports our clients, mostly around the space of Forex, buying and selling, hedging their risks, yeah, in terms of financial market risks. So that's interest rate risks, commodity risks, and the like.
Yep. Okay, so Charles, right now I think the key issue that everyone is grappling with is how to make an extra buck. Mm. It's how to invest. There is no money. We are all broke. We are all talking about the economy, the challenges. So if you're talking to anybody out there listening to you about investments, how to grow their money, what advice would you have?
Sure. No, it's a tough time, as you said. Yeah. But in all that, just before I start, just remember nothing lasts forever. Good times don't last forever. Bad times as well don't last forever. And if you have that mantra, the next best thing really for you is to plan. And so if you know that there will be good times and there will be bad times, you need to build that war chest. So there are various ways you could do this. I mean, traditionally we bought land, we've saved in properties, we've bought some assets, I won't say cars and all that, but the different ways people have planted forests, all those are investments, yeah? I think what COVID has taught us is that you need a mix in terms of your planning for that future. So you need a mix of different assets to invest in. Fixed income assets are very good because they provide a steady cash flow. They have risks associated with them. You probably also need a trading portfolio if you have the time. People that buy and sell things, yeah, if you have that time to supervise that effectively, it's critical. Then you also need assets that appreciate or gain value over time, so which is your land, houses as well. The point I'm trying to make here is that there is no one size fitting all. Different people have different risk appetites. We're in different seasons in our lives. You need to spread it out. The key thing, you need to invest. So if we go, you need a minimum of 100,000 for you to invest. The average return now on a 15-year government paper is around 17%.
That's above inflation, isn't it?
Way above inflation. Inflation is at 10, that's headline inflation. So as I told you, you only need 100,000 to invest. Probably, and I think for banks like ours, Stanchart, the transaction costs almost zero. Yeah, so
how does someone, off the street, I want to invest with
Standard Chartered Bank, for instance? What do I need to do?
So, as I said, you've selected the asset class.
Yes.
You think you'd want to lend to government and earn that 17%. All you need is approach the bank, establish a relationship. If you don't have one yet, if you do, reach out to your RM, relationship manager, who will give you the requirements. The requirements are very basic. A couple of passport size pictures so that we know who we're talking to, what they look like, identification, again,
national
for us,
ID.
National ID, just to be sure that this is Cynthia, we know where she comes from, and just tell us what the source of funds are, again, just for us to be sure that there's nothing untoward behind it. Then we'll open an account within the bank and also with the central bank.
So anybody can do it?
Anyone. I told you minimum amount is 100,000.
Great.
Yeah. So that then sets you on course for that fixed income that will keep coming regularly. So you can imagine during COVID you're seated at home, some jobs were lost, some incomes were halved, but you have this steady fixed income that keeps coming through.
How often does that income come through?
So it's paid twice a year, mm-hmm. So every 6 months. It's called a coupon, what you really earn, it's called a coupon. So you earn that every 6 months. So now you know you have your 100,000, a million shillings, that's 170,000 split two ways. You're going to receive every 6 months. Now that is money you won't be looking for. You could spend this money over some enjoyment. Yeah. So anyway, that's one asset class I think you need to consider. As I said, you also need, and the good thing with fixed income, before I move on to the next, also they do appreciate. They have market prices, so at times you also get that appreciation in value. But same way as they do appreciate, they do depreciate, and so that's a risk.
Yes.
you need to know. As I said, having something that trades is also good, but the critical thing is the good thing with trading, because it's high turnover, you can grow your profits or reward quite quickly, so that's why it's attractive. The other thing I mentioned, things like land or houses as well, you can also buy land, yeah, and I think it's a trade we've all tried, yeah, we've all gone into that space where you, and influenced by our friends,
yeah.
That tells me, you know what, there's a huge piece in Gayaza, let's go. And some have worked out well.
Charles, that is so interesting. So if I want to buy land vis-a-vis build rentals, as an expert, a thought leader in this investment space, what would you recommend? Like if I really need to, you know, to choose between the two, and I think that's a conversation that most people have. Would you build rentals or put in bonds, you know? Which one, what advice would you give?
Okay.
I know they're both
yeah.
good and they're both valuable depending on where you are in life and
mm-hmm.
how much disposable income you have. But if I'm a start out and I'm a hustler, what would you recommend?
Yeah, and I said this at the start, we're all different.
Yeah.
And as easy as it sounds, investment is not really it's not a numerical or a qualitative decision. It's a lot more emotive than mathematical, if I may put it that way.
Forex market now, and the shilling was stable, but on a quiet appetite, on quite a low appetite for dollars. The local currency traded within 3810 and 3820 levels throughout the session. That was supported by the month inflows that started to trickle in. Of course, that is at the start of the week. But let's now take a look at the comprehensive report of the money market. So I did see a report that was saying as the fuel prices drop, is it too early for us to jubilate? I tell you what, it doesn't matter how much it has dropped by, whether it is 50 or 100 shillings, any person that uses fuel will be happy that there is a reduction. So yes, we have a reason to jubilate, and we can only hope that the fuel prices keep dropping, because when they drop, then the cost of business just somehow goes down, because almost everything that is in business involves transport. Let's take a look at how the different petrol stations across the region in the country are faring. Okay, so before we go, Bill Gates once said that your most unhappy customers are your greatest source of learning. I'll just say that again. Your most unhappy customers are your greatest source of learning. If your customers are not happy, don't push them away. As a business person, take a step back, listen to them, and find a better way of improving the things they're complaining about. People like say the customer is the king. So if they're happy, the business owner will definitely be happy. That's it for this week. Thank you for making time. Feel free to get in touch. And for those of you looking for more tips, Business Clinic happens every Tuesdays on Rush Hour here on Urban TV. Until then, you take care of yourselves. My name is Simon. We'll see you soon.